In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Come, Holy Ghost, and fill the hearts of thy faithful, and kindle in them the fire of thy love. Send forth thy Spirit, and they shall be created, and thou shalt renew the face of the earth. Let us pray. O God, who didst instruct the hearts of thy faithful with light of the Holy Ghost, grant that by gift of the same Spirit, that we may be always truly wise and ever to rejoice in his consolation through the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Saint Joseph, all the guardian angels and saints, Our Lady of the Angels, name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Welcome back, all of you viewers and attenders or attendees at Catechism. We're going to continue the Sacrament of Penance. I first started the explanation of the Catechism of the Council of Trent on penance back in February. And we've had a few classes intermixed with the commandments, if you go back and look at the previous catechism videos. But I'd like to finish this topic today, as future catechism classes need to be dedicated to the commandments, which is also part of our catechetical instruction from the Council of Trent. And then, of course, to cover the other sacraments, which are still missing without explanation yet, especially that of extreme unction. So we're in the second part on penance, and this is about page 281 in our books. Two books I wish to introduce to you today. The first one, which I will reference today on a couple questions of catechism, and that is the Confession, a Little Book for the Reluctant, put out by Tan Publishers. The book is written by a priest. His name is Monsignor Louis Gaston de Segur. Translated from the French by the Sisters of Charity in New Haven, Connecticut. So 10 books. Confession, a Little Book for the Reluctant. And we'll cover a couple of his points today. He has many points, let's say questions that he refutes or answers that easily come up in the life of a penitent, someone who's either new to confession or someone who's just may be bothered or tempted by not making his confession or her confession. You are welcome today to present a couple questions that are connected with this subject. I can't always guarantee that I'll get to all of the questions, but if you'd like to leave a question on our live chat, you may do so, and I'll do my best to answer what I can if there's time before the end of the class. The other book, number two, that I will introduce to you for a story today, as the beginning of our class, is a book of stories for children. And this book is the book that I have been using for many years. It's just a photocopy is what I have. It's Bruce Publishing Company of Milwaukee. It's the book of Father Brennan's favorite stories. Father Brennan's favorite stories by Reverend Gerald T. Brennan. Great stories for children who are making first confession, first communion, or maybe any child who needs a good story of his faith or religion. And what I'm reading today as an introduction to our class has to do with our conscience. And it's his story number 43, called The Tired Old Clock. Before I start this story, notice here that I put contrition, confession, satisfaction. Those are the three points that we've been covering in the penance, the Sacrament of Penance, and we'll get to a reminder of that in a moment. First, the story. 73 years, that's a long, long time. It's a long time to live. It's a long time to work. Very few people, you know, live for 73 years, and I've never heard of any person who worked 73 years. Now, in the little village of Fairview, there was a grand old clock that was 73 years old. For 73 years, the faithful old clock lived in the steeple of the village church. Many of you know Grandfather's Clock stood on the shelf. You know that song. Well, think of that song as we read this story. Day and night, the old clock smiled down on its many friends. The clock was never fast. It was never late. It was always on time. And every hour, the grand old clock struck out the time of day or night. The town clock suffered in the summer heat, and it shivered in the cold of winter. For 73 years, the village clock was everyone's friend. I've often wondered how many people have looked up at that clock. I've often wondered how many people have set their watches by the town clock. I suppose I'll never know. The people of Fairview loved their village clock, but there was one thing that people didn't know. The old clock was tired. It was very tired. The old clock was tired of working 24 hours a day. It was tired of ticking and talking day after day and year after year. Why wouldn't it be tired? Hadn't the old clock worked hard for 73 years? The old clock needed a rest, but no one knew it. Well, one night last January, it was very cold. It was very quiet, too, because the people of the village had gone to bed. As the tired old clock looked down upon the darkened village, it decided to do something it had never done before. Now that everyone is asleep, said the clock to itself, I think I'll take a little nap. A little sleep will be good for me. So the tired old clock stopped its ticking and talking and went to sleep. And what do you think? The old clock was so tired that it forgot to wake up. And there was excitement in the little village of Fairview that next morning. Was there? Yes, there was plenty of excitement. And that sleeping old clock caused lots of trouble. The morning train arrived to carry men and women to the city, but there were no passengers. Breakfasts were late, and the paper boy was late, and the people were late for work. Many of the people didn't go to work at all. Why, the priest was even late for Mass. And children were late for school. Everyone was angry, and everyone blamed the tired old clock that went to sleep. Can you see how much the people of Fairview depended upon the village clock? That clock steered the lives of every person in that village. That clock gave the people to work, got the people to work, on time. That clock got children to school on time. That clock brought people together for business, for pleasure, for work. That clock told people when they should go to parties or the movies. It told people when they should go to bed. The old town clock did a grand job for 73 years, but the old clock failed one night last January when it got tired and went to sleep. Do you know, boys and girls, and all of you listening, that God has given each of you something that steers your lives? God has given each of us, each of you, something that never wears out, something that never gets tired, something that never goes to sleep. This gift from God is called your conscience. Your conscience is the little voice inside of you that always checks you, the voice that is always telling you what is right and what is wrong. The voice is trying to lead you to heaven. Let's suppose you're walking down the street and you see a large basket of apples in front of a store. You wish you had one of those apples. You're just about to steal an apple when a voice inside of you tells you not to steal. That voice is your conscience. Your conscience reminds you that it's a sin to steal. So you change your mind and don't steal the apple. That's the way your conscience works. It's always on the job to tell you what is right and wrong. Your conscience pulls you away from sin and leads you to God. So, did you ever fall into sin? Did you ever disobey God or break one of His laws? How did you feel after you committed the sin? Were you happy? Indeed, you were not. You felt guilty. Do you know why you felt guilty? Your conscience was telling you that you had done wrong. Your conscience was warning you that you should not do that and that you do not do that again. Your conscience spoke to you and checked you and warned you about the future. There's one big mistake that many children make, and probably all of us, don't we? They don't listen to their conscience, and that's when they get into trouble. When children don't listen to their conscience, they usually fall into sin. Of course, your conscience will bother and annoy you. And it's a good thing that it does. After all, most boys and girls want to be good. No one wants to be bad. So when your conscience bothers you, your conscience is really helping you. Your conscience is the voice of God. When your conscience nudges you or whispers to you or taps you on the shoulder, God is warning you to be careful. God is telling you to keep away from sin. Children, all of you watchers, God doesn't want to lose you. That's why He has given you a conscience. So when your conscience speaks, listen. Then follow your conscience in all things. Your conscience will keep you close to God, and your conscience will lead you to God. So that's where we are when we're studying the whole fact, reality, truth of sin, and the necessity for confession. We have many problems in today's society, much need for psychotherapists, psychologists, psychiatrists, because people don't make good confessions, or maybe they don't make any confessions. So therefore, the soul gets tighter and more wrapped up in guilt. And how is this meant to feel? Very unhappy, even depressed. So let us continue on helping our conscience by the sacrament that our Lord Jesus Christ gave to us, the Sacrament of Penance. So we are here at the second part on confession. We're just going to spend a little bit of time on that. We need to get to satisfaction. Now, forgive me if I have repeated myself or covered some of this information before. Again, it's not covered so thoroughly that we can never say any more about it. And I would wish for you to read your catechism, whether it be My Catholic Faith, whether it be the Baltimore Catechism, or whether it be the very Council of Trent itself. Know your confession. Know your sacrament of penance. Okay, here we are. Just a few more words then on confession itself. The care and exactness which its exposition demands of pastors must be at once obvious. If we only reflect that most holy persons are firmly persuaded that whatever of piety, of holiness, of religion has been preserved in our times in the church through God's goodness, think about the church today, must be ascribed in great measure to confession. We will find this piety, holiness, and this religiosity in the churches, in our parishes, in our families, in a great part due to confession. And we, in the Society of St. Pius X, as priests in this modern age, trying to save souls and promote the Mass and preserve the priesthood, confession is so important, so important for souls. The more confessions we can provide, the holier is a parish. It cannot, therefore, be a matter of surprise that the enemy, we know who that is, of the human race, in his efforts to destroy utterly the Catholic Church, would, through the agency of the ministers of his wicked designs, have assailed with all of his might this bulwark, as it were, of Christian virtue. Yes, there's this virtue of penance. We talked about that once before. You can go back and look at that in previous videos. And then there's the very sacrament itself. And you can believe me that many bishops, many priests, and a lot of the faithful now believe that confession, take it or leave it. Useful at times for some, maybe not for all. You could go years without making a confession. Just keep going to Holy Communion. Holy Communion is a very powerful sacrament. It is the presence of our Lord always, his body, blood, soul, and divinity. Yes, when we receive our Lord, it purifies all sin. But what man in this daily concourse and his daily workings amongst men, and knowing he is wounded by original sin, who is out there that says he doesn't need to make use of the sacrament of confession or penance anymore? I am an old man. I'm never tempted like that. Oh, I've never committed a mortal sin in my life. Well, good. And the way we're not going to is by confession. And, of course, we're required to do so by the Church, our Easter duty. Precepts of the Church. So, Council of Trent says, we must emphasize to you, the dear faithful, first place, that the institution of confession is most useful and even necessary to us. It's not something we can take or leave. We must make use of it. So the necessity, contrition is true, it is true, blots out sin. I have to be sorry for my sins. We said that already. That's the first part of this act of penance, contrition. But this follows. Who can say his contrition is genuine if he doesn't try to follow it up with confession? But who does not know that to effect this, it must be so intense, so ardent, so vehement as to bear a proportion to the magnitude of the crimes which it effaces? Think of that. The crimes which we commit, there's no way we can pay or have a sufficient sorrow equaling what has been done or what has been omitted. So we need the sacrament of confession to bring us back to the satisfaction of that sin, because otherwise It's not proportional. He says, this degree of contrition which few reach, and hence in this way very few indeed could hope to obtain the pardon of their sins, is therefore very necessary. It's become necessary that the most merciful Lord should provide by some easier means for the common salvation of men. And this he has done in his admirable wisdom by giving to his church the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Our Lord said that to his apostles. He says it to all of us priests. What you bind is bound on earth. What you unbind in heaven is unbound in heaven and bound in heaven. So whatever the church, by her keys of confession, bind or unbind, that's the way it is. According to the doctrine of the Catholic Church, a doctrine firmly to be believed and constantly professed by all, if the sinner have sincere sorrow for his sins and a firm resolution of avoiding them in the future, and although he bring not with him that contrition which may be sufficient of itself to obtain pardon, all his sins are forgiven and are remitted through the power of the keys. When he confesses them properly to the priest, we call that attrition. He must have at least attrition when coming to confession. It may not be contrition perfectly, but he has to have something going on in his soul of sorrow. Advantages to confession. Obviously, we priests, you yourselves, dear faithful, know the great advantages of confession. We may turn to a fact taught by experience. To those who have led immoral lives, nothing is found so useful towards a reformation of morals as sometimes to disclose these secret thoughts, get it out there so it's no longer a hidden thing, and therefore it has less importance. It falls flat. The error comes out of it. It's not as much a temptation if we tell someone, especially our Lord, the priest, the church, in confession. What an advantage. The prudent and faithful friend who can assist by his advice and cooperation. For the same reason, it must prove most salutary to those whose minds are agitated by the consciousness of guilt. We just talked about conscience in the story of Father Brennan. To make known the diseases and wounds of their soul to the priest as the vice regent of Christ, our Lord, bound to eternal secrecy by the strictest laws. The priest cannot tell your sins to anyone. They will find immediate remedies, the healing qualities of which will not only remove the present malady, but also have such a heavenly efficacy in preparing the soul against an easy relapse. Yeah, it must be trusted. It must be believed in. Another advantage of confession, which should not be overlooked, is that it contributes powerfully to the preservation of social order. Listen again, dear faithful. Number one advantage is that we get rid of the consciousness, this guilt in our conscience, these wounds of sin, and we find a remedy. Another advantage, which should not be overlooked, is that it contributes powerfully to the preservation of social order. You abolish the sacrament of confession, and that moment you deluge society with all sorts of secret and heinous crimes. Crimes, too, and others of still greater enormity, which men, once they have been depraved by vicious habits, will not dread to commit an open day. And that's where we're at today. In today's society, the things that used to be of the hiddenness, secretness, have come to the back alley. And now they've left the back alley and they're in the front street. They're in all of our homes even. Very gross, very depraved. These depraved, vicious habits have now been committed in open day. The solitary shame that attends confession restrains these vices, licentiousness, bridles desire, and checks wickedness. Okay, so what's a definition of confession after saying these advantages? Remember, I'll just write them up for you. First, the advantages that we just talked about. Advantages of confession. It proves solitary. Oops. Solitary is a type of medicine. Remedy to guilt, for guilt. And then, of course, two is this very advantage where social order is kept in check. Social order kept in check. And protect it. Now think of where we're at today, in today's society, in today's world. So many sins, not only that have come out in the open, that are being promoted, but even the ones whereby it doesn't even matter what we do to our neighbor. Aside from the things we're being a bad example in, now we're even reaching so far as to hurt other people. Criminals just on the loose. Think of all the riots. Think of all the sins against their fellow men. Incredible. Nobody worries about just doing it. And then as though the consequences don't even matter. Now here we are at this definition of the confession. St. Augustine says it is a disclosure of a secret disease with the hope of obtaining pardon. St. Gregory says, confession is a detestation of sins. We can call it, as laid out by fathers before us, a sacramental accusation of one's sins made to obtain pardon by virtue of the keys of the church. It's rightly an accusation because sins are not to be told as if the sinner boasted, as they do who are glad when they have done evil. Be careful of that. Not only do you want to accuse yourself without boasting in the confessional, but you also afterwards, after confessing them, you don't want to be boasting about them. It's as though we're not sorry then. Don't be proud and laughing about your sins when you should be sorry for them. And therefore, dear men and women, when you bring up an occasion in your life, or maybe you're telling somebody your past history, you're giving an example of how you change your life, don't make light of sin, don't laugh at it, don't make it sort of a proud, like, yeah, look what I used to do. No, that's wrong. And that doesn't show much contrition, if any. We confess our sins with a view to obtain pardon, and in this respect, the tribunal of penance differs from other tribunals, like going before a judge in the civil court, which take cognizance of capital offenses, before which a confession of guilt does not secure acquittal and pardon, but penalty and punishment. So again, the definition by the Holy Fathers, either confession as defined by St. Augustine or confession as said to be by St. Gregory, it is a disclosure of a secret disease, hope of obtaining pardon. It's getting rid of our sins which we detest. Confession was instituted by Christ. We believe this. It's been upheld by the church. It's a duty of the greatest moment that pastors should unhesitantly teach that this sacrament owes its institution to the singular goodness and mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has ordered all things well and solely with the view to our salvation. He doesn't need it. He didn't need the sacrament of penance for himself. His mother didn't need it. No, it's for our good. Restoration of baptismal innocence. The setting on the path again, on the straight and narrow. A remedy for us when we find ourselves burdened by wounds of sin. Conscious of our sins. This weight in our conscience of sin. That little worm that gnaws away at us. We know we've been made for God and we won't rest until we rest in Him, says St. Augustine. So how can we do different than God? It's going to weigh on us. Our Lord seems to have signified the same thing when, having raised Lazarus from the dead, he commanded his apostles to loose him from the bands in which he was bound. It's amazing that Holy Mother Church, the Council of Trent, uses that as an example. He died and was bound. He's coming forth from his tomb. He's resurrected by the power of our Lord Jesus Christ. He commands his apostles, unbind him. That's a good image of us for confession. So, to this also refers a command given by our Lord to the lepers cured on the way, that they show themselves to the priests and subject themselves to their judgment. One other thing I wish to add at this moment, if we seek figures in the Old Testament, the different kinds of sacrifices which are offered by the priests for the expiation of different sins or sorts of sins, seem beyond all doubt to have reference to the confession of sins. The sin reparations and other sacrifices, look at them, read about them. When you read through the Old Testament, keep that in mind. Is there a figure of confession here? Of the reparation for sin? Of the excusing from sin? Certainly. It's there in the Old Testament. Rites added by the church. Not only are the faithful to be taught that confession was instituted by our Lord, they are also to be reminded that by authority of the church, certain rites and solemn ceremonies have been added, which, although not essential to the sacrament, serve to place its dignity more fully before the eyes of the penitent and to prepare his soul so that, kindled with devotion, he may more easily receive the grace of God. When with uncovered head and bended knees, with eyes fixed on the earth and hands raised in supplication with other indication of Christian humility, not essential to the sacrament, we confess our sins. And then our minds are thus deeply impressed with a clear conviction of the heavenly virtue of the sacrament. The proof of obligation is laid out in our catechism. This truth is clearly conveyed by our Lord himself when, by a most beautiful metaphor, he calls the power of administering the sacrament the key of the kingdom of heaven. Just as no one can enter any place without the help of him who has the keys, so no one is admitted to heaven unless its gates be unlocked by the priests to whose custody the Lord gave the keys. The power would otherwise be of no use in the church. If heaven can be entered without the power of keys, in vain would they do, or would they, to whom the keys are given, seek to prevent entrance within its portals. So, the same thought was familiar to the mind of St. Augustine. He said, "Let no man say within himself, I repent in secret to the Lord. God, who has the power to pardon me, knows the inmost sentiments of my heart. Was there no reason for saying, whatsoever you loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven? No reason why the keys were given to the church of God?" So St. Augustine finishes with those two questions. What is the purpose then of all that our Lord said? Same doctrine is taught by St. Ambrose in his treatise on penance, when he's refuting the heresy of the Novatians, who asserted that the power of forgiving sins belongs solely to God. And he says, "Who yields greater reverence to God? He who obeys or he who resists his commands?" So who's given the greater reverence? He who obeys or he who resists God? God commands us to obey his ministers, and by obeying them, we honor God alone. Well, then, as we have come up to this time of year, May, the month of May, many children are making their first confessions, receiving First Communion, Holy Communion for the first time. The law of confession was no doubt enacted and established by our Lord himself. It is our duty to ascertain on whom, at what age, or what period of the year it becomes obligatory. According to the canon of the Sacred, the Council of Lateran, so the Sacred Council of Lateran, omnis utrusque sexus. No person is bound by the law of conscience until he has arrived at the use of reason. A time determined by no fixed number of years. It must be done under great counsel to scrutiny, discernment by the priest and his parents, the parents of the child. Is this little person ready? It may, however, be laid down as a general principle that children are bound to go to confession as soon as they're able to discern good from evil, and are capable of malice. For when a person has arrived at an age when he must begin to attend to the work of his salvation, he is bound to confess his sins to a priest, since there's no other salvation for one whose conscience is burdened with sin. Remember that. Baptized baby, until it starts to make rational acts, it dies, it goes to heaven. it doesn't make a rational act contrary to God. But at that moment, when it can, we need to be on it. We need to know it. And we need to help them to confession. That's why I don't like to say, oh, nobody goes to confession until they're 7 years old. Well, that's too blanketed. That's too limiting. There may be sins committed by a child from 5, 6 to 7 years old. And he needs to go to confession. He knows the right from wrong. He knows that he's doing malice, malicious things. And the parents and the priests need to be there as good guides to help him to get rid of his sins. If at the same time he's ready to go to communion, so be it. But we're talking about first the sacrament of penance, sacrament of confession. So at what time the law of confession obliges? Okay, in the same holy canon, Holy Church has defined the period within which we are especially bound to discharge the duty of confession. It commands all of the faithful to confess their sins at least once a year. If, however, we consult our eternal interests, we will certainly not neglect to have recourse to confession as often, at least, as we are in danger of death or undertake to perform any act incompatible with the state of sin, such as to administer or receive the sacraments. The same rule should be strictly followed when we are apprehensive of forgetting some sin into which we have fallen. For we cannot confess our sins unless we remember them. Neither do we obtain pardon unless our sins are blotted out through sacramental confession. I wish to briefly cover the qualities of confession. The qualities of confession. Confession should be entire. Sins are concealed. Sins forgotten. Also talking about our confession being prudent, modest, and brief. And our confession should be made privately and often. All right. Qualities of confession. Let's put them down here. Qualities of confession or of penance. Must be entire. Let's just say covering all of our sins. Pastors should teach, that's all of us, that first of all, care must be exercised that your confession be complete and entire. All mortal sins must be revealed to the priest. Venial sins, which do not separate us from the grace of God, into which we are frequently falling, although they may be usefully confessed, as the experience of the pious proves, or the saints. They may be omitted without sin and expiated by a variety of other means, some of which I've mentioned before, taking holy water, saying the confiteor before Mass and before Holy Communion, maybe some other plenary indulgence gained, or partial indulgence of venial sins. As the Council of Trent has defined, such has been the constant teaching of the Church. In confession, we should employ all that care and exactness which we usually bestow upon worldly concerns of great moment. All our efforts should be directed to the cure of our souls, to the wounds that we have, and the destruction of the roots of sin. We should not be satisfied with the bare enumeration of mortal sins, but should mention such circumstances as considerably aggravate or extenuate their malice. Some circumstances are so serious as of themselves to constitute mortal sin. So that on that account, no detail could be omitted. If it's known that the circumstances aggravate the sin mentioned, we have to say them. Because it could very well change the gravity. Thus, if one man has killed another, he must state whether his victim was a layman or an ecclesiastic. Now, obviously, murder is already bad, but let's say a man had gone to war and he had said, well, I was in war and I killed some men. I shot them. They were shooting at us, we shot at them. And yet I think I messed up because I didn't have necessarily shoot that guy at that time. He was running the other way. I don't know. But that's quite a bit different than saying, I just shot a man and then you find out it is a priest. That would really aggravate the situation. Thus, he says here, the Council of Trent, if one man has killed another, he must state whether his victim was a layman or an ecclesiastic. Or if he has had sinful relations with a woman, he must state whether the female was married or unmarried. A relative, or even a person consecrated to God by a vow. These circumstances change the nature of the sins. So the first kind of unlawful intercourse is called by theologians simple fornication, whereas the second is adultery, the third incest, and the fourth sacrilege. Again, theft is numbered in the catalog of sins, but if a person has stolen one golden coin, his sin is less grievous than if he has stolen 100 or 200 or an immense sum. And if the stolen money having belonged to the church, the sin would be still more grievous. Sometimes we use the example of the poor man in the street who only has $10 for his food. If somebody stole it from him, that's more grievous than if I had stolen it from a rich man, because that little amount suddenly had a great gravity. Remember that a certain gravity is always a mortal sin. Normally that used to stand in moral theology at $100. But imagine, like I say, the $10 to the man in the street is like $100, and maybe all he has to eat his next meal, and somebody steals it from him, that's a grievous sin. Circumstances do make a difference. We don't need to be telling a story in the confessional, but we need to be wise enough or ask the priest, well, Father, I have some of the circumstances here I'd like to mention to you, because I wonder if they change this sin. Or somebody could say, you know, well, I committed this A, B, and C, or these type of sins. And then the priest says, by hearing it, he says, well, do you mean this, this, and this? Oh, yes. Well, that's a bit different. That's even more involved and much more grievous. And that's the way you'd want to confess it, not hide it. So also the rule applies to the circumstances of time and place. Circumstances such as these, therefore, to be mentioned, but those which do not considerably aggravate the malice of sin may be lawfully omitted. All right, that's the entireness. Two, watch out for concealed sins. So important is it that confession be entire that if the penitent confesses only some of his sins and willfully neglects to accuse himself of others, which should be confessed, he not only does not profit by his confession, but involves himself in a new guilt. A new guilt. He's profaned the sanctity of the confessional. Concealed sins? Question mark. Profane. I'm going to write it. What did they say? They wrote it as, profanation of the sacrament. So, it's very important. It must not make us anxious about confession, but it must help us to be clear. Sins forgotten, the confession should seem... Or should the confession seem defective, either because the penitent forgot some previous sins, or because, although intent on confessing all of his sins, he didn't examine the recesses of his conscience, he is not bound to repeat his confession. He must have sufficient understanding and desire to be sorry for all of his sins in the confessional and before he leaves, although later on he could always bring back a sin and say, Father, I never mentioned this before. I know I was forgiven my sins, but this sin I never brought to the keys of the church. But he doesn't have to go back in and say, oh, Father, I forgot his sin. No, because it's just it. He forgot it. He didn't purposely hold it back. There are a few other things to say. Confession should be plain and simple and sincere. You could also say that falls under those things already mentioned. It should be prudent, modest, and brief. And the confession should be made privately. Prudence and modesty in explaining matters of confession are also to be commended, and a superfluity of words is to be carefully avoided. Whatever is necessary to make known the nature of every sin is to be explained briefly and modestly. You don't have to go into a lot of details that would either tempt yourself or the priest. Confession may be made privately and often. Secrecy as regards confession should be strictly observed, as well as by the penitent as by the priest. And the faithful should be careful to, above all, to cleanse their consciences from sin by frequent confession. When a person is in mortal sin, nothing can be more solitary, so precarious is human life, than to have immediate recourse to confession. But even if we could promise ourselves a long life, yet it would be truly disgraceful if we are so particular in whatever relates to cleanliness or dress of person, yet the luster of our souls we leave sullied. We should be as concerned. If we're so concerned about our hygiene, of keeping ourselves bathed and well-dressed and having nice things around us, why wouldn't we do so with our souls by making use of the sacrament? It's a good thing for parents, husband and wife, to take their children, to have their confession day, to go to confession the same time or the same week, so that there's no sort of, oh, I didn't get a chance. Oh, we all went that day. We all had gone, but you didn't pay attention. So it's good. If the parents can help to get the children in a routine, then they'll do it on their own. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the minister of the Sacrament of Penance, which would be normally talked about here. You can certainly read about it in the Council of Trent. I do want to emphasize to you that normally you approaching a priest and asking for confession is sufficient supply jurisdiction for him to hear your confession. Now, normally the pastor of the place and his delegated assistants are the ones who hear the confessions. But if there was, says, in order that none may perish, if there is imminent danger of death, recourse cannot be had to the proper priest. The Council of Trent teaches that according to the ancient practice of the church, it is unlawful for any priest not only to remit all kinds of sins, whatever faculties they might otherwise require, but also to absolve from excommunication. So you see, the Holy Mother Church is very pastoral. She's very motherly towards souls. So for all of those times, gosh, it was many years, where we were accused of hearing confessions without jurisdiction. Yes, by the strict definition of being in a diocese and being a parish priest, yes, we did not have that jurisdiction, which is ordinary or delegated jurisdiction. No, we had supplied jurisdiction. People needed to have their confessions heard, and they needed to be able to be heard in a traditional manner, not being told, oh, those aren't sins anymore. Oh, you don't have to go to confession. Well, we got rid of that sin years ago. That's crazy. People have their souls on the line, and they need a confessor. They're welcome to ask any priest. Obviously, there's qualifications to be a minister, which I don't need to talk about here. The priest should know this, normally because he's a judge, physician, etc. He needs to be able to do his job in the confessional, acting in the place of our Lord. He doesn't have to be a scientist. He doesn't have to be the greatest intellectual in the world, but he has to be a man who can make a good, solid, common sense judgment, and himself hopefully working on his holiness so that can be conveyed to the faithful. All right. The third part of penance, which we must finish with then, is the satisfaction. The satisfaction, is very, very important. It's very, that cannot be overlooked in the sacrament. Now we must talk about it now. Third part of penance, satisfaction. We begin by explaining its nature and its efficacy, because the enemies of the Catholic Church have on these subjects taken ample occasion to sow discord and division to the serious detriment of Christians. So what do we mean by the word satisfaction? Payment. Full payment of debt. For that is sufficient or satisfactory in which nothing is wanting. You take a man's cow, you have to give him back the cow, or its equivalent. So the satisfaction must be made. Hence we speak of reconciliation to favor, to satisfy means, to do what is sufficient, to atone to the angered mind for an injury offered. And in this sense, satisfaction is nothing more than compensation for an injury done to another. But to come to the object of that now engages us, penance, confession, theologians make use of the word satisfaction to signify the compensation man makes by offering to God some reparation for the sins he has committed. So, various kinds of satisfaction to God then. This sort of satisfaction has several degrees and can be understood in different ways in various senses. So first, satisfaction, the definition is just the payment of the debt. Payment. Also, we might call it compensation. Oops, that's supposed to be a C. Compensation. Then he's going to say, they're going to say in the Catechism, what are they? Well, one, the first and the highest degree of satisfaction is that by which whatever we owe to God on account of our sins is paid abundantly, even though he should deal with us according to the strictest rigor of his justice. This degree of satisfaction appeases God and renders him propitious to us and is a satisfaction for which we are indebted to Christ our Lord alone. So, this is abundant payment, or paid abundantly, paid fully, I'll just say. And this can be done, and this equals Christ. Kiro. I'm just going to write the Kiro. Christ. Paid fully, that's Christ. The only way we can truly satisfy that is with Christ, by Christ, with Christ, in Christ. No created being could have been of such worth as to deliver us from so heavy a debt. Another kind of satisfaction, which is called canonical, is performed within a certain fixed period of time. Hence, according to the ancient most practice of the church, when penitents are absolved from their sins, some penance is imposed, and the performance of which is commonly called satisfaction. So we'll call that canonical. You tell your sins, the priest says, do this. Okay, you have to do that. That's your canonical penance, the satisfaction. By the same name is called any sort of punishment endured for sin, although not imposed by the priest, but undertaken by you. So the priest tells you, do 2 decades of the rosary, canonical penance. You know you can't completely pay back. You're going to have to trust Christ for that, the sacrament, the laying on of his blood through the sacrament. But here you are, you got to do your penance. So you do, canonically. But you could also add on. So there are, thirdly, the spontaneous or punishments imposed on yourself or by others. Punishments taken upon oneself. So you take them spontaneously, you want to do more and perform by yourself. There are a few elements of sacramental satisfaction we could talk about. I'm going to go over this very briefly. It does not belong to the penance as a sacrament, only that satisfaction constitutes part of the sacrament, which, as we've already said, is offered to God for sins at the command of the priest. Furthermore, it must be accompanied by a deliberate and firm purpose carefully to avoid sin for the future. For to satisfy, as some define it, is to pay due honor to God. And this is evident. And this, it is evident, no person can do who is not entirely resolved to avoid sin. So we must be resolved to avoid sin. It's an aspect which we must follow us. From the moment we say our sins until we go out of the confessional and start living our life again, we must have this resolve. In accordance with this idea of satisfaction, some have defined it as a cleansing which effaces whatever defilement may remain in the soul from the stains of sin, and which exempts us from the temporal chastisements due to sin. So we cut off all occasions of sin and close every avenue against its suggestions. We could also talk about the necessity of satisfaction. It will not be difficult to convince the faithful that the necessity imposed on the penitent of performing works of satisfaction is proper. They are to be taught that sin carries in its train 2 evils, when I commit a sin, the stain and the punishment. Whatever the stain is effaced, or whenever the stain of sin is effaced, the punishment of eternal death is forgiven, with the guilt to which it was due. Yet, as the Council of Trent declares, the remains of sin in the temporal punishments are not always remitted. That's why plenary indulgences are so important. That's why we'll talk about the sacrament extreme unction. That has that ability to take away the stains that are remaining outside of sacramental confession and the temporal punishment. Any remains, any traces. We read about in Exodus, our Lord yielded to the prayers of Moses and spared the idolatrous Israelites, yet he threatened the enormity of their crime with heavy chastisement. How many times our Lord reminded us of that in the Old Testament? Okay, back in good favor, but this is a consequence. Uh-oh. So the advantages of satisfaction are, and seems to be required by God's justice and mercy, it atones to the church, and satisfaction deters others from sin. Never forget that saying. Not only must justice be done, but it must be seen to be done. In the old times in the church for various serious sins, public sinners were actually doing public penance. And everybody saw that. Whoa, I'm not going to do that sin. Or, this is terrible. I don't even want to be in a position to have to do penance like that. And even by satisfaction, we are made like unto Christ. Satisfaction can even heal the wounds of sin. So many advantages that I would encourage you to read in the Council of Trent. Around pages 299 through 301. All right, well, the duties of the confessor as regards satisfaction, we don't need to cover too much as that concerns primarily the priests. But the quantity and quality of penances should be reasonable. In imposing penance, priests should do nothing arbitrarily, but should be guided solely by justice, prudence, and piety. In order to show that they follow this rule, and also to impress it more deeply on the mind of the penitent, the enormity of his sin, it will be useful sometimes to remind him of the severe punishments inflicted by the ancient penitential canons, as they are called for certain sins. The nature of the sin, therefore, will regulate the extent of the satisfaction. No satisfaction can be more solitary than to require of the penitent to devote, for a certain number of days, some time to prayer, not omitting to pray to God on behalf of all mankind, and particularly for those who have departed this life to the Lord. Okay, for instance, somebody commits a grave sin, they've been away from the church for a while, it's not and would not be unfounded for the priest to say to him, go on a retreat, make the Station of the Cross for a couple days, maybe do a week of rosaries for your penance. Those are certainly not even as heavy as the sins committed, but certainly a reminder that the quantity and quality of penances should be impressing upon the mind of the person the enormity of his sin. Voluntary works of penance should be encouraged or recommended. And then even public penances can be given. Here's what the Council of Trent says. Should it be deemed proper sometimes to visit public crimes with public penance, and should the penitent express great reluctance as to seek to escape from its performance, he should not be listened to too readily, but should be persuaded to embrace with cheerfulness and readiness that which will be so solitary to himself and to others. And such was a case when I was in another parish, and I noticed something openly grievous had been done to others in the parish, not so much physically, but by verbal crime. Then I said, okay, write me an apology. I'm not expecting you to come to the front of the church or to even stand out front in ashes, but give me the apology and I'll read it to the rest of the parish, which I did. They wrote their apology and I read it for them. These things concerning the sacrament of penance and its several parts should be taught in such a manner as to enable the faithful not only to understand them perfectly, but also with the Lord's help to resolve to put them in practice piously and religiously. I would like to bring your attention to two questions from Father Monsignor Segur, when he says the following. In his different points that he heard or knows about people who are reluctant with confession, he says the following. One of them is, I do not want a priest to interfere in my affairs. Unfortunately, God wills such interference, and we must submit to it. Your affairs, my friend, are the priest's affairs, inasmuch as they concern the service of God and the affairs of your conscience. You're not talking about the grocery guy. You're not talking about the cop on the street. You're not talking about the fireman. You're not talking about the mailman. You're not talking about even the doctor. You're talking about the priest, whose duty it is the salvation of your soul, the remission of your sins, and your union with God. He can involve himself in your affairs. And does not the priest interfere only with your affairs of conscience, leaving you yourself and all things to pertaining to religion? The priest has not only a right, but a duty, a vigorous duty. First, to teach you, in general and particular, what you ought to do and what to avoid, what is good, what is evil, what is permitted, what is forbidden. And secondly, after you've taught, he's having taught you, he must by every means, even at the risk of tiring and annoying you, excite you to serve God faithfully and avoid in your household affairs, in your business transactions, etc., all that is forbidden by the sovereign master who alone is God. So you see, somebody using that argument, it's unfounded. Some people don't like to hear about confession from the pulpit. So he came up with this question: why do the priests not leave us alone instead of always talking about confession? It's a funny thing with us. Talk about confession, and people either they start to feel their guilt, therefore they have to either go to confession or they have to step further away from the church or further away from the confessional, further away from the sacraments. Well, what would we love to have somebody do? Not tell us anything? Not ever direct our soul? Not ever wake it up? No, I'd rather somebody woke up my soul so I don't lose it. Simply because they fulfill their duty and try to make us good, even in spite of ourselves. A priest who leaves people alone, who does not excite sinners to repentance, is an unfaithful, slothful priest. A prevaricator. Zeal for the glory of God and the salvation of souls is the summation of the priestly ministry. Priests are the spiritual police of God on earth. They send out and pursue and seize the sinner as our police and detectives pursue and arrest the scamps of our city. And then, what use is confession? Well, what use is it to wash and comb and brush your hair, to be clean? Confession is the toilet, of our conscience. The priest washes, cleans, combs, scratches, and brushes the soul sullied by sin. He restores it to its good condition, white and clean. Wow, who would not want to be clean? Like our Lord said, St. Peter said, well, wash my whole self then, not just my hands, not just my feet. No, said our Lord, you don't need to do all that. And he is clean. He restores it to its good condition, white and clean. Children who will not allow themselves to be washed and dressed by their mothers remain all day dirty and disgusting. Souls who will not allow themselves to be cleansed in confession are dirty, foul, mean souls. So what is use of confession? What is this confession? Every use. It serves to restore us to peace with God when we've had a misery to offend him. It serves to give us peace of heart, true happiness, and true joy. The other day, a lad of 16, laughing and crying at the same time, exclaimed, I never was so happy in my life. He just made a general confession, which he much needed. Confession serves to prevent a host of sins, disorders, scandals. I would add crimes. How many young men and young women owe their good conduct, their honor, to nothing but the habit of going to confession? It is for them what the prop is to the vine, to keep it upright, to keep it from falling over and breaking. It sustains it. It keeps it from falling into the dirt and ripens its fine grapes by holding up to the sun. Without this prop, the poor vine, trodden underfoot, would creep along the earth, useless and without fruit. And if it did bear any fruit, it would rot. What is the use of confession? A Protestant minister said, we must acknowledge that this confession is an excellent thing. He had just received a note for 1,000 francs from an unknown thief who, after 18 years, had made up his mind to go to confession. So therefore, he pays back his debt. A Lutheran minister whom I know personally, who became a Catholic on his deathbed, told me one day that twice in his life he had been robbed. Twice in his life he had been robbed. The first time was in a Catholic village and of a sum of about 20 francs. After Easter, the priest of the place returned to him the 20 francs. The second time it was in Sivanez, the heart of Protestantism, and again, a pretty round sum. But, this is the quote, "But from the first moment I counted my money lost, there was no confessor there to oblige my robber to restore it. In fact, I have never recovered a single crown of that money, because it was in the midst of a Protestant town. There was no priest to hear the confession of the robber. He never got his money back." Poor Protestants never get their money back. All right, well, I leave the rest to you to read and pursue, dear faithful, on this holy sacrament of penance, referencing the book Confession, a book, a little book, for the reluctant by 10 publishers. We also had the book of Father Brennan by the Milwaukee Publishing Company, Bruce Publishing. And then also we were referencing the Catechism of the Council of Trent. This is my old version, the Roman Catechism, also published by 10 books. All right, we will finish with a prayer, and hopefully it won't be too long before we have another video on catechism. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost. As now and ever shall be, world without end, amen. Lord Jesus crucified, all the guardian angels and saints, pray for us and watch over us. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, amen.